नमस्कार दोस्तों, आपका एक बार फिर से स्वागत है हमारे चर्चित कार्यक्रम कल्चर मैटर्स विद कैलाश में। दोस्तों, आज के इस कार्यक्रम में हमारी मेहमान हैं बैसाखी मित्र, जो आज बात करेंगी सुंदरबन के बारे में, जहां पर बंगाल टाइगर्स पाए जाते हैं। तो और इसके बारे में विस्तृत जानने के लिए हम अपने वरिष्ठ सहयोगी डॉक्टर कैलाश कुमार मिश्रा जी के पास चलते हैं। सर, आपका स्वागत है कल्चर मैटर विद कैलाश में।
थैंक यू मुकेश। आप सभी का कल्चर मैटर्स विद कैलाश में ये जो फोक ब्रेन का कार्यक्रम है उसमें स्वागत है। आज जो हम लोग बात करने जा रहे हैं वो सुंदरबन पे करने जा रहे हैं। सुंदरबन जैसा नाम से ही लगता है, सुंदरबन, ब्यूटीफुल जंगल, ब्यूटीफुल फॉरेस्ट, फॉरेस्ट ब्यूटीफुल। इट इज द ओनली मैनग्रोव फॉरेस्ट इन द वर्ल्ड वेयर द टाइगर्स आर फाउंड एंड द बिगेस्ट, दे आर फाउंड इन द बिगेस्ट नंबर। दे हैव द कैपेबिलिटी टू स्विम, दे सर्वाइव ऑन द यू नो द फिश एंड अदर थिंग्स, एंड देर आर सो मेनी ब्यूटीफुल thing, bioculture diversity, people's dimensions, it connects two countries, and there are some serious threats also. So the beauty is being threatened, and so many dimensions are associated, and we think that the culture and nature, they go together. You cannot find culture is flourishing without nature. Nature decides the ultimate, you know, the physiography, physiognomy of culture. And this is what we are going to hear from the mouth of Dr. Baisakhi Mitra. Dr. Baisakhi Mitra is a very, very famous scholar of museology, and she has done significant job. She is assistant professor in charge of Department of Museology at Rabindra Bharati University, Calcutta. She is also a curator in charge of the Rabindra Bharati Museum. Dr. Mitra specializes in museum management and education and has been researching and teaching various aspects of museology for the past 20 years. An alumna of International Center of Culture and Heritage Studies, University of Newcastle upon Tyne, UK, Dr. Mitra has many national and international papers to her credit. She has also received number of prestigious awards like Chevening Fellowship, Charles Wallace India Trust Fellowship, and the Nehru Fulbright Senior Research Fellowship. These things indicate her capability, her scholarship, her interest in various aspects of tangible and intangible culture of India. And she has been working with the people, with the area, land, area, and ecology, biodiversity of Sundarban. So she is going to deliver a talk with her PowerPoint presentations, with video, with audio, whatever she has. And she is also going to share her concern and concern of the social scientists, concerns of the museologists, and concerns of every sincere citizen of the world about the biodiversity. If we are not serious about it, is going to be ruined. So, madam, we are really, the folk brain team is really thankful to you, because in single request you agreed to deliver this lecture. And I tell you the beauty of this space, it is a you know public space where you are free to deliver your lecture. We reach to usually 50,000 people, and visually we have opted two languages, Hindi and English. So you have a liberty to either speak in Hindi or English, and sometimes you can use English, some Hindi and some English, because you may find some of the audiences may not understand English very well. In that condition, they also have right to know the things in detail. So if, like, you know, slightly you can manage, that will be good for the audience, for the listeners, and for all of us. With this, I request you to come and deliver that. Thank you so very much.
Thank you, Dr. Mishra, for such a kind introduction. And thank you for giving me the platform to speak about Sundarban. It's an issue that is not only near to my home, but also near to my heart. Wherever I have traveled throughout the world, if given a scope and if given a free choice to speak, I have always spoken about Sundarban. I have always tried to highlight the needs of the people in the area. As academicians and as museum and heritage activists, I think it is our responsibility to uphold all the areas that need attention in our local. Like I said, think globally, act locally. So I'll speak on this topic today, Sundarban's World Heritage Site, a cry for help. I'll just take a minute to go on screen and share my screen. Let me know if I'm visible, if the PowerPoint is visible, and if I'm audible, okay?
Okay, I will tell you. Not yet has it come. It will come, it will come. Mukesh, please take care. Okay, it is visible now. Okay. It is visible now. Okay. Yeah.
And you can hear me also?
Yeah. Please continue.
Okay, great. So I'll start. Namaskar, everyone. And I hope all of you are safe and healthy in these difficult times. Our country is fighting a tough battle, and my state, Bengal, is no exception. However, with the Amphan cyclone hitting the state on 20th May this year, Bengal is in for some extra tough time ahead. And in Bengal, no region has been more severely hit than the Sundarbans, which is the biggest prograding delta with the single largest mangrove forest in the world, with nearly 100 tigers. 100 sher ka duniya hai ye. This unique and fragile landscape with its vibrant flora and fauna is also a designated World Heritage Site. In this inclement geographical area resides a population of nearly 4.5 million people whose daily life is not only against difficult weather conditions, but also against the tiger, which often turns man-eaters. And as they struggle, I mean the people, as they struggle against these adverse natural forces, they weave a beautiful tapestry of songs, dances, and music. The heritage that we see in Sundarban is unique in nature, as nothing like it is found anywhere on the earth. But before we take a look at the heritage components of the area, I would like to take you quickly through the historic, demographic, biological, and socio-economic components of the Sundarban that has shaped the culture of the region. The total area of Sundarban is about 10,000 square kilometers, and the Indian part constitutes 4,200 square kilometers of reserved forest, which includes Royal Bengal Tiger Reserve, the Sundarban National Park, and three wildlife sanctuaries, besides another 5,400 square kilometers of non-forest inhabited region is in India that encompasses the Sundarban Biosphere Reserve, which is unique in the sense here not tiger is treated separately, but tiger is treated in relation to man. So both of them get saved. Both the species get the same attention by the conservation efforts. The name Sundarban literally means the beautiful forest. Sundar meaning beautiful and Bon in Bengali means forest. It is also related to the name of the dominant mangrove tree in the area, which is called Sundari, that grows very well in the coastal saline soil. The scientific name, in case any botanists are out there in the audience, is Heritiera fomes. The world's largest prograding delta is formed by the confluence of the three great rivers of Ganga, Brahmaputra, and Meghna. The Indian Sundarban Delta is bounded by the Ichamati and Raimangal River in the east. If you look at the map here, it's this part, it's the Ichamati and Raimangal River here. And then on the Hooghly River in the west. And here the red line that you see is the Dampier-Hodges line, which demarcates the eastern part of Sundarban. Now let's have a look at the region from space. It's very interesting. This is Sundarban as we see from the space. You can see how many crisscross canals are there and how many little parts of land we can see. Most of this part of land gets underwater during high tide, and they get exposed when there is low tide. So this is a very interesting picture of Sundarban from space. So thus it is a transition region between the fresh water of the rivers originating from the Great Himalayas in the north and the saline water of Bay of Bengal. If you look at these two pictures, the one at the top, this clearly shows the time when the high tide is into the forest. And you can see the top of the trees exposed. And here down below, you see the picture during the low tide, where even the stilt roots of the mangrove forest have got exposed. So you can see the difference of level of water in the region, and that too twice a day. So this is a very difficult terrain to live in. Historically speaking, now let's have a look at the history of the region. The history of the area can be traced back to 200 to 300 AD. And during the Mughal period of 16th and 17th century, the kings leased the forest to nearby residents. Many took refuge in the Sundarbans from the advancing armies of Emperor Akbar. In fact, during this time, many have been known to be attacked by tigers. The buildings which were built by these initial settlers later fell into the hands of Portuguese pirates, salt smugglers, and dacoits in the 17th century. The area was first mapped in 1764, soon after the British East India Company obtained property rights from the Mughal Emperor Alamgir II in 1757. No conservation effort was made, and to improve the condition of the people was looked never got the attention of the government during this time. Now, despite the regulations, between 1873 and 1968, the mangrove covered area of the forest decreased by about half because of conversion of forest to agricultural land and settlements. This can be attributed to mass migration to the Sundarbans after the end of the colonial rule and the creation of India and Bangladesh as two separate countries. This resulted in the mangrove forest boundary shifting further to the south and area between the Hooghly River and the Matla River being cleared. However, post-independence, various wildlife and forest protection legislations were established by the country, and the Sundarban mangroves have been protected by legal measures mainly established to protect and help increase the threatened tiger population. The natural heritage that we find in Sundarban is beyond experience. The UNESCO has designated the World Heritage status to the areas for its unique natural beauty, ethnobotanical interests, special marine faunal interests, rivers, creeks, islands, swamps, estuaries, mud flats, and tidal flats. The site supports exceptional biodiversity in its terrestrial, aquatic, and marine habitats. Ranging from micro to macro flora and fauna, the Sundarban is of universal importance for globally endangered species, including the Royal Bengal tiger, Ganges and Irrawaddy dolphins, the estuarine crocodiles, and the critically endangered endemic river terrapin. It is the only mangrove habitat in the world for Panthera tigris species. Here you can see some of the species. It's not possible to show all of them, but you have the tiger, the deer, crocodile, the monkeys, and of course, variety of snakes of the area. The other rich faunal heritage that Sundarban has are those of different bird species. So you have the Bahamini duck, you have the kingfisher, the woodpecker, the stork, the greater billed stork. So loads of birds also come into this area during migration. As far as the demography is concerned, the population, human population, the profile of Sundarban is very interesting, and it represents the amalgamation of various socio-cultural elements that, under the influence of a harsh, inhospitable terrain, has produced the most unique heritage components. Sections of the population represent immigrants from other areas in West Bengal and parts of what is now Bangladesh. The others are descendants of settlers who arrived during the days of colonial administration, mostly the Oraos and the Mundas. There are two distinct categories apparent among the past settlers. One group came here in search of new opportunities as the frontier was being opened up, while the other group came to escape oppression in these places of origin. A further category consists of a small group of people of tribal origin from the to clear the forest. This group has remained on the margins of the society and quite literally in the margins of the island. As of now, the population is more or less evenly balanced between two major religions, Hinduism and Islam. The caste and religious identities are not found to be very strong determining factors, possibly for the following reasons. Number one, there's a rapid physical change along the edges of the island. So the common person living on these islands have to adapt constantly to the changing scenario. And the dangers of daily living is also very high. So what they have done is they have found a beautiful way of mixing the two religion and finding a religion that is unique for Sundarban and a religion which is not found anywhere else. Although there is no village inside the tiger reserve, there are more than 1,000 villages, out of which around 100 are very close to the reserve, especially at the north and the northwest fringes. As far as livelihood is concerned, people go out for extraction of resources of such as biomass, that is wood, honey from forest area, and they also do a bit of agriculture. Nearly 95% of the population is primarily agricultural, which is mostly rain-fed monocrop. Why rain-fed? Because here the water is so saline that you cannot use the river waters for irrigation. So the only thing that they can depend on is the rainwater. And both the groundwater as well as the surface water is of extreme salinity. About 50% of the agriculturists are small, landless, marginal farmers. It's a very poor area. During agricultural lean season, people resort to fishing and collection of prawn seeds, even risking their lives from man-eating tigers and crocodiles. There is no major industry in the area, and only small industries like pottery, wooden furniture, making bidi, rope making has come up, mostly based on traditional skills. And again, these have very local small markets. The big market that is there is of the prawn fishing. But then again, that is also very deleterious to the environment, about which I'll speak a little later. Inaccessibility of the region and dearth of industrial facilities is responsible for the backwardness of the area. In the recent time, tourism, especially ecotourism, has brought in some meager revenue, but is mostly controlled by tour operators from Kolkata. And the locals do not play a very active part in the industry in the controlling sense. The culture of Sundarban is also unique in many ways. By interactions of humans, nature and wildlife have given rise to a new dimension of cultural landscape in Sundarban. This is reflected in the soft heritage associated with honey collection, religious festivals, myths and folklore, music and dance. The primarily agricultural and fishing community lives close to the forest, which they share with the Bengal tiger. The hardships of daily existence have given rise to fraternal feelings and traditions. The inhabitants have gradually embraced a life that is isolated from the mainstream metropolis culture and that gets expressed in many ways and typically suits the local forest customs and beliefs. One of the major problems of the area is the man-animal conflict. The lives of Sundarban residents are frequently affected by human-animal conflicts. A few tiger and crocodile attacks every year are very common. According to authorities, 10 tiger attacks take place every year, but villagers claim that it is at least 10 people die of tiger attacks every month. The count reaching 30 in times of cyclones and floods, when the land-water divide becomes soluble and the forest and the human settlements converge. A majority of the population depends on the forest resources for their livelihood, like wood cutting, honey collection, fruit collection, wax collection, crab collection, breeding prawns and fishing. The salinity of the soil is unfavorable for agriculture, even though working on land is the most sought after option so as to avoid going into the forest. But much of the time when crops fail, they have little option but to go into the forest and face the tiger to get their living. In fact, there is a village which is named after as Tiger Widow's Village, because all the men in the villages have been eaten by tigers and only the women are left. So such is the sorry state of affairs there. Here you can see how close tiger and man lives it. In the top picture, you can see that they are fleeing from seeing the tiger. And here is a tiger who have killed one of the domestic cattle belonging to the village. So this is one confrontation that they have to keep facing every day. This is an interesting picture. These are the fishermen going out to fish. And since you know the canals in the Sundarban area are very narrow and sometimes water is very low, tigers often they swim onto the boats and they catch the fishermen. So to confuse these tigers, they wear these kinds of masks behind their head. So the tiger is confused as to which is the right side of the man to take hold of. So this is the simple technology that they have found out to try to save themselves. As far as religion is concerned, I think it is the most interesting part of the culture of Sundarban. There is hardly a living soul in the Sundarban whose life has not been touched by the forest or by the tiger. Be it the fishermen on the boat, the honey or the wax collectors or the woodcutters, they all enter the forest for livelihood. And in doing so, they seek out divine protection in the form of gods and goddesses. As I earlier mentioned, the population of the area has nearly equal numbers of Hindus and Muslims. But the unique feature of the religious practice is that both the communities pray to the same deities specific to the Sundarban mangrove jungles. They are Bono Bibi, this lady sitting down here. She is the Bono Bibi, the king, the queen of the forest. And then next to her is her brother Shah Jongoli, who is also a protector. And this is Dokhin Rai. They don't take the name of the tiger in fear that the tiger may attack them. So this is Dokhin Rai. That is what they call. And this is the Dukhi, or the representation of the simple common man who goes into the forest in search with protection from Bono Devi. This is probably the only place in the world where the Islamic communities perform deity worship. The local belief goes as such: Bono Bibi, or as the Hindus prefer to call it, Bono Devi, accompanied by her brother Shah Jongoli, is the main guardian deity of the forests. Irrespective of caste and religion, people pray to her for safety and security from any sorts of forest danger. She is worshipped mostly by the honey collectors and the woodcutters for protection against attacks from the tigers, whom they call Dokhin Rai. Besides the regular worship of Bono Bibi, an important and major festival also takes place around this worship during the month of March. The image of Bono Bibi, as we see here, is worshipped by her Hindu followers as Bono Durga or Bono Devi, and by the Muslim followers as Bono Bibi. And her predominantly Hindu images are found as wearing a sari with a crown and garland, carrying a club and Trishul, and her Bahan, or the vehicle, is a tiger. Both the Hindu and the Muslim images have a boy in her lap, the little boy that I just showed you, believed as Dukhi by her worshippers. On the contrary, her brother Shah Jongoli has Muslim appearance, although in some places it has been seen that he takes on a Hindu look as well. It's obviously a Hindu iconography, and it has not been an impediment for Muslim devotees, nor do her Muslim followers see any contradiction in praying to her statue present in omnipresent makeshift temples. In a landscape such as this, Bono Bibi becomes a focal point for faith and absolute devotion. There is an anecdote among the people of Sundarbans on the Indian side that there was a fight between the tiger god named Dokhin Rai and the forest queen, that is Bono Bibi. Dokhin Rai fought for the rights of the tigers and Bono Bibi fought for the rights of the humans. But no one won the fight, and it ended in a draw at the behest of another person called Ghazi Mia, on the fact that the forest would be divided equally between humans and tigers. That was the decision taken after the fight. People there also do a lot of folk dance about this story. Many counter narratives are also present. We find different kinds of temples dedicated to Bono Bibi as well, or Bono Devi. The temples are mostly of two kinds of types. One, as you see in the first case, this picture, it is at the forest where people give heads before going inside the forest. These temples are very simple. There is a clay statue of Bono Bibi in them. The temples built in the villages are a little grand compared to them. The one next to it, this is the village temple, which has a concrete permanent structure. There are Hindu gods and goddesses along with Bono Bibi. Unlike the one in the forest, which has only Bono Bibi and Shah Jangoli and Dokhin Rai, in the temples which are located inside the villages, you have other deities as well. In some, Bono Bibi sits with Dokhin Rai, and in some, there is a statue destroying him, destroying Dokhin Rai. In some temples, besides the Bono Bibi tiger symbol, Dokhin Rai, deer, fish, crocodiles, or poultry also reside. It is worth noting that Bono Bibi and the symbols associated with her all point to a deep connection with the people. The interesting fact is that none of these temples have any doors. That is the reason they have kept it open for the common man to come in and pray at any time of day or night. So that is a very interesting fact. And again, both Hindus and Muslims, they offer prayers here. I have a little anecdote by Saeed Naqvi about his interpretation of Bono Bibi cult in Sundarban. Let's hear him.
यहाँ पे लोग जाके बड़े नेट से बड़े जाल से छोटी मछली और जंगल में जो खेती मछली एक तरफ तुम मच्छर से बचो वो अगर उससे बच जाओ तो बाघ से बचो सुंदर बंस का ये इलाका बाघ के लिए ये है कि कई लोग हजार इलाके में एक गाँव में बाघेल यानी टाइगर विडो वो गाँव जहाँ की औरतों के संपर्क बाघों यहाँ पे एक उसका नाम है बॉन जंगल गॉडेस कोई भी बुत तराशी होना है देखने के लिए उनकी कैसे ले रही है क्योंकि ये इलाका है दुर्गा शक्ति से देख रहे हैं बहुत दीदी सुंदर वंश की काली है शक्ति है लेकिन वहां के मुसलमान खुद ही कि अगर खुदा न होता तो इंसान को बनाना होता लिहाजा यहाँ जरूरत पैदा हुई बॉन बीबी की तो इंसान ने अपनी इंजेन्युटीज का एक गोया खुदा नुमा खुदा का पैगंबर जो कि औरत वो यहाँ बना के ये खुद इंसान का इन्वेंशन था और अब वो अपने आप को उससे प्रोटेक्टेड महसूस करता है फिर आपका एक शेर है खुदा को अहले जहां जब ना चुके तो फिर खुदा को जब बना चुके तो फिर बात थे कि इतने हमें
So nicely put in such a short time. That is the cult of the Bono Bibi. Now, the cult of the Bono Bibi has also given rise to a number of intangible heritage. of which one important is the Bono Bibi Pala Gaan. It is a dramatic performance tradition which is connected with the worship of goddess Bono Bibi. The word Pala means long narrative in verse, and the Gaan means song in Bengali. Previously, it was only sung or recited as an eulogy to the deity to get her blessings. Later, it evolved as an enactment form from where the various excerpts of the Sundarban were acted out for entertainment. Though initially it was unwritten and was passed down from generation to generation orally, much has been scripted right now. Here you can see a stage set for the Bono Bibi Pala. It's much like the Jatra Pala that we have in West Bengal, which is a character of West Bengal. But the themes are all related to the Sundarban area. So here you have Bono Bibi sitting on the tiger, and here you have Shah Jangoli, her brother, next to her with the big club in his hand. And this is Dukhi, the little boy who gets lost in the forest and is saved by Bono Bibi. And this is Dukhi's widowed mother who was calling Bono Bibi to save her son. Now, Bono Bibi Pala Gaan has now developed into two forms, the traditional Bono Bibi Pala Gaan and the contemporary Bono Bibi Pala Gaan. The traditional Bono Bibi Pala Gaan can be further categorized into two kinds of representation. One is the Akani Pala and the other is the Bono Bibi Pala Gaan. The word Akani comes from the word ek, and it is the solo performance by one artist who sings and narrates the story and also acts out certain parts of the narrative. The main singer is called the Gayan and is usually accompanied by a dohar or an accompanist. The dohar plays the music and occasionally engages in dialogue with the Gayan during the performance. I would have loved to show you a bit from this Pala Gaan, but the problem is a Pala Gaan is for at least 1 hour, and showing you a little clip from there would not satisfy you. So I would suggest, if you're interested, go on to YouTube. There are full Pala Gaans there and you can watch them at your leisure. The other contribution of Sundarban to the intangible heritage of India is the Bhatiali song. Is the tradition of Sundarban, and it's inspired by the mystic rivers and the lives of the river boatmen. Bhatiali is a folk song form known for its long drawn notes and is traditionally sung by boatmen when rowing downstream. The name's origin is in the word bhata, which means the ebbing tide. The music is inspired by the confluence of nature, and some expresses one's pure love for his or her beloved through simple language. Some songs even depict the love of Radha and Krishna. Bhatiali songs are usually sung solo with little or no instruments and occasionally with a stringed dotara. And it has survived because of a few legends who are still living and their love for music genre. There are at least 45 Bhatiali artists in the two districts of North and South 24 Parganas, where the Sundarban is located, who are engaged with the rural craft and the cultural hub projects. I have a little bit of Bhatiali song for you. It's one full song. Composition is by Joshimuddin and the singer is Limon. If you hear carefully, you would know how many times S.D. Burman and Kholil Chowdhury has lifted tunes from the Bhatiali song. So let's hear.
আমায় ভাসাইলি রে, আমায় ডুবাইলি রে, অকুল দরিয়ার বুঝি কুল নাই রে, আমায় ভাসাইলি রে, আমায় ডুবাইলি রে, অকুল দরিয়ার বুঝি কুল নাই রে। অরে কূল নাই সীমা নাই অথই তোমার পানি, অরে কূল দরিয়ার পানি আমায় দিল শুনি শিখে থাকে আমায় দিব শুনি শিখে থাকে দিয়াত ছানি দরিয়ার বুঝি রে আমায় ভাসাই আমায় ডুবাই রে অকুল দরিয়ার বুঝি নাই রে বানসা জলে ভাসাই সাগরের মনে বানসা জলে ভাসাই সাগরের মনে কত লক্ষ বছর পার হইল কত লক্ষ বছর জানে রে দরিয়ার বুঝি ফুল নাই রে আমায় ভাসাই রে আমায় ডুবাই রে অকুল দরিয়ার বুঝি ফুল নাই রে ওরে কূল নাই কিনার নাই নাই কদরিয়ার বাড়ি কুল নাই কিনার নাই কদরিয়ার বাড়ি তুমি সাবধানে চালাইতো মাঝি তুমি সাবধানে চালাইও মাঝি দরিয়ার বুঝি কুল নাই আমায় ভাসাই রে আমায় ডুবাই রে কুল দরিয়ার বুঝি কুল নাই আমায় ভাসাই রে আমায় ডুবাই রে অকুল দরিয়ার বুঝি
Such beautiful melodious tunes. No wonder it had inspired SD and Shorin Chaudhary. The other gift that Sundarban has specifically given, and that it is also found in other parts of West Bengal and Assam, but the speciality is that the Sundarban Jhumur is very lively, like other Jhumur also, but the theme is also very specific to the local area. And West Bengal, as it is the place of origin of Jhumur music, and later on it spread out to the border region of Bangladesh. And music has an important role in the lives of the Adivasis of Sundarban. These are the Adivasis who have traveled from Chotanagpur Plateau to work in as laborers in Sundarban area. So groups such as the Shautal, Munda, Orao, Ho, they were brought to this region by the British in the 19th century. As indentured laborers, they cleared the forests and they barricaded the rivers. This was their work. Now, their descendants now speak Bengali after decades of living in West Bengal. They use song and dance and try to preserve the memory of their original languages, such as Banwa. Some have formed groups like the Tugiri Adivasi Tushu Sampradaya, and villagers and tourists look forward to their performances, which provide the Adivasis with a source of income and help them sustain cultural heritage. Male artists are keeping in this picture, as you see, the male artists are keeping the rhythm of the dance with some simple musical instrument like dhol or flute or tal, and the girls mostly perform the dancing part rhythmically. It is believed that Jhumur is the means of recreation of the common people, which depicts joy and sorrow of everyday life. There are two characteristics in the practice of Jhumur. First, it goes up to a crescendo, the dance and the music, and then gradually descends down to the diminutive. And then it becomes stable in the lowest note in its musical harmony. Secondly, in this singing tradition, the balance between the crescendo and the bass note remains unchanged. This singing pattern is also a part of the folk music. The subject matter of traditional Jhumur song is the earthly love of Radha and Krishna, and this is performed by dancing and singing. Now, modern Jhumur songs also take on contemporary issues. I'll show you a Jhumur dance, and the song that is going on with this this dance is very contemporary and very familial with us. And this, it is, there are dialogues and there are big dramatic effects, so that makes a complete performance. So let's have a look at one of the Jhumur dances. This has been performed in one of the tourist resorts.
Can you increase the sound while it is not coming properly?
One second, right. The volume has been.
Please increase the volume so that.
Better?
Yeah.
Thank you.
Okay. It's so difficult to sit still with a Jhumur song going, but anyway.
Yeah, yeah.
As we see, it's a very fast-paced, cheerful song. And it's one of the liveliest folk dances of Bengal and it's choreographed and performed throughout the year to mark all happy occasions and festivities by professional artists. The group that you saw is dancing in a hotel resort. You won't believe for this performance, they'll get maybe 200 rupees per day. It's such meager is their income. Now let us have a look at the fairs and festivals of Sundarban area. It has a number of important festivals, of which the Ganga Sagar is the most famous, as it is a renowned place for pilgrimage on the western part of the Sundarban Delta in West Bengal. This place is considered to be holy because the river Ganga has a confluence with the Bay of Bengal Sea. Every year in the auspicious days of Makar Sankranti, a huge fair known as the Ganga Sagar Mela is held here and people are seen taking a holy dip in the river Ganga, believing that taking a dip on this particular day will wash off all their sins. Millions of devotees of Lord Shiva covered in ash, sannyasis in their typical saffron robe, men wearing big and small colorful turbans on their head, women dressed in beautiful silk or cotton saris is normal sight during the week long grand festival. The first week of January, it's usually held in the first week of January and it is called the Ganga Sagar Mela. In fact, it is the second largest mela after the Kumbh Mela. And it comes alive with an array of shops selling heaps of rudrakshas, vermilion, etc. The other important thing about Ganga Sagar Mela is the Kapil Muni Ashram is right here. So a lot of worship goes on there also. The other important fair of the area is the Bono Bibi Mela, which is important for both the Hindus and the Muslims. It is also held in every year during January to February. And the biggest fair in these fair is the one that is done in 24 Parganas of West Bengal. Women of both Hindu and Muslim religions keep a fast on the day and they eat only when the sun sets. And people come to the fair and ask for different vows, depending from children to good crop and everything. So it is also a very important fair. The other fair is the Dokhin Rayan Mela, which celebrates the tiger goddess. And there are the Kajon festival, which is also very much present in other parts of West Bengal. And it is also present in Sundarban. And the government has started a Sundarban folk festival, which is bringing in some kind of money once a year for the different performers and the different singers and the Jatra Pala performers. So that is another new festival that has been added to the list. However, despite this, we know that the threats to Sundarban are immense. We really don't know whether this place is going to last very long. The population has increased from 1.15 million in 1951 to 4.44 million in 2011. So you can imagine the kind of population pressure that has happened. And with that, what has happened is there has been clearing of lands for agriculture purpose, for other settlements and everything. They have cleared the lands. So forest cover has also reduced. Now the annual cyclones and floods have been a constant nuisance for the people. Now this year we had Amphan, last year there was Bulbul, and every year that some or the other cyclone comes and breaks the barrages and breaks the barns and breaks the houses of the poor people. Coastal erosion is a major factor here, which degrades the ecosystem. Of course, there is felling of trees and illegal poaching of animals that goes on. Altered freshwater inputs, and as climate change is happening, the sea level goes up, and as the sea level goes up, the saline water comes into the Sundarban land area. And now Sundarban, the mangrove forests are not adapted for high salinity, and the crops that grows inland is not adapted for salinity at all. So with the high saline water, both the mangrove forest suffers as well as the crops that is being cultivated by the people. Now, there have been increased industrial development in neighboring countries. Like you see in this picture down, there have been oil spills and industrial effluents flowing into Indian part of Sundarban from factories set up in Bangladesh. Now, this is very interesting fact is that Sundarban, we can't treat Sundarban just as a little part of West Bengal. It extends out to Southeast Asia, covering a huge part into Bangladesh, and it goes down to Orissa and then some parts in the eastern coast as well. So, treating Sundarban for conservation purpose, we need to have an integrated approach. Now, the other threat to Sundarban is the unscientific shrimp culture, aquaculture. Shrimp export is a major industry in parallel to Sundarban's economy. But what happens is that they throw in these huge nets to catch the fish, the shrimps. And along with the shrimps, a lot of other fish and everything comes into the net, which they just throw away. So the entire ecosystem is being hampered. And what I hear, this is also a problem in the whole of Southeast Asia. So we are not alone in suffering from these menaces. Now, tiger targets the villagers' livestock and increasing the village themselves. And we have nobody to blame but us, because constant felling of trees and constant clearing of land have left them with almost no habitat. Very, very low area, and now we have about 100 tigers roaming there. I must mention here is that till recently, Bangladesh and India, they had separate tiger centers, and India used to count about 10 tigers on this side, and then these 10 tigers used to cross over to Bangladesh, and Bangladesh used to count 10 tigers, and we used to add up and say 20 tigers, because tigers don't really care for international boundaries. But thankfully, the last tiger census has been jointly done by the two countries, and now we have a more or less stable count of the tigers. Now, the villagers are also unable to farm, and they are experiencing dwindling fish catch and they are forced to venture deep and deeper into the tiger territory to look for crabs and collect honey. Of course, the core area of the tiger reserve is out of bounds for them. They are not allowed inside. But illegally, many of them go in and they face the tiger. Many of them die, and they put their lives at greater risk of being attacked by these big cats. And the problem of Sundarban has been complicated by the transboundary management. We have international borders running right through Sundarban, time and time again. One between India and Bangladesh. Then, as you travel further to the east, you have more international borders. So that is one immediate issue that we need to address. Before I leave you, I'd just like to show you this short, very scientific documentary I really like, which shows in a nutshell the crisis that Sundarban faces.
Sundarbans. An iconic landscape where fresh water meets seawater. A place ruled by the rhythms of the shifting tides. A landscape that changes twice a day. And holding this ever-changing world together are the mangroves.
What a beautiful.
This aquatic maze hosts a diversity of specially adapted life. Thank you. from the smallest to the top of the food chain. The Bengal tiger, found in no other mangrove forest on earth. Humans thrive here as well. Millions depend on the rich resources of the Sundarbans. But these forests are more than just a source of livelihood. They are also the greatest protectors of this region. The Sundarbans lie in the path of cyclones or in the Bay of Bengal. The frequency of storms has increased with climate change. The most recent cyclone Bulbul was devastating. But things could have been worse. Mangrove forests act as shock absorbers. They protect against wind and waves. Without the Sundarbans, cyclones would reach the city of Kolkata and ravage it. But this protective fortress cannot be taken for granted. In the last 200 years, more than half of the mangrove cover in the Indian Sundarban has been cleared for cultivation and human settlements, leaving deforested areas exposed to the savage forces of nature. But recently, a more sinister threat has emerged. With global warming, sea levels are rising faster than ever before. The rising water brings with it more salinity, tipping the delicate balance of fresh water and salt water. Mangrove species that cannot survive in extremely saline waters will perish. Scientists predict that large regions could be underwater in just 50 years, driving the last swamp tigers to extinction, leaving millions of climate refugees homeless and the city of Kolkata defenseless. But not all is lost yet. Only if we fiercely protect what is left of the mangroves. The complex roots bind and trap the soil, building land and creating climate resilient coastlands over time. In this vulnerable part of the world, these extraordinary forests are the only protection against the extremes of nature. One of the planet's greatest wildernesses and a living wall of defense that protects a whole civilization beyond it.
Between 1969 and 2009, the Sundarbans lost 210 square kilometers of land. And the future is not any brighter. About 250 square kilometers of a previously productive zone will be lost in the next 5 or 10 years, thanks to coastal erosion, cyclones, and estuary changes. as per the World Bank report, which also says that the annual cost of environmental damage could range from rupees 344 crores to rupees 1065 crores. The problem that Sundarban faces is too big. It cannot be handled by the state government alone. It has to be a national effort, there has to be an international effort, and in a most coordinated manner in which all the countries which have these mangrove forests join hands to protect them. Let the sun always rise on the people of Sundarbans. Let's unite our voice to save this land. Thank you.
Mukesh. So it was a great, great master presentation by a master scholar. You know, you have presented the ethnography. You have told us about the fauna and flora, about the birds which are migratory and about the birds which are full-time birds here in the locality, about the crabs, about the fish, about the tigers, about the endangered, about the people, about the how the two communities, Hindus and Muslims, are living together, about the relationship between the humans and non-humans, how the humans decided that let us divide the land between the two equal halves, half would go to the animals and, you know, other things, our remaining half would be for the human activities. You have also talked how, you know, on the basis of agriculture, on the basis of irrigation, and for doing, you know, industrial revolution, for the money we have been ruining it, you have also indicated how through the cyclones and other things, 200 and something square yard, square kilometers land are being ruined. It has dumped into the deep, you know, the sea. And you have also talked that how the harmony between the two nations, India and Pakistan, is being maintained by the people of two different countries. And you have said the dangers that we have been facing in Sundarban. You have also talked about the grooming of the population that this area has been facing. If this trend continues, it is going to ruin the entire ecosystem and the land of Sundarban. There is no doubt about it. It is therefore the responsibility of not only the government, the scientific community, the decision makers, the planners, the central government, the state government, and the world body to think sincerely about Sundarban. Because Sundarban does not belong to Bengal, it belongs to the world. It is a world heritage. It's a world heritage. So it is the responsibility of the world citizen to take care of it systematically, scientifically, nationally, culturally. And your presentation, I must tell you, was a wonderful presentation. There was little bit of information for every viewers, listeners. Those who have been listening it right now, those who are going to listen it later, and it is going to be a very good archival material for Folk Brain. Thank you so very much, and we are really very delighted. We are getting wonderful comments from the people. They say wonderful talk and presentation, ma'am. Girja Barik says very informative and beautiful presentation, ma'am. Thank you for sharing the knowledge and the information with us. Yes, I know. We have been working. There is an organization called Read India, and I am the consultant with that group. So there is a village called Ulon in near Sundargarh, and Sundarban, and we have been working there. So there is a person called Kapilda Mandal. And Kapilda Mandal is as good as, you know, Muhammad Yunus in Bangladesh. So, you know,
I know him.
So he's a friend of us. We are working together. He's a friend of us. I have visited that place many times. I have seen the entire, you know, the White House. He has created the White House. He has created the India Gate. So that the poor people, they don't have money. They don't have time to come to India Gate, to go to America and see all those things. So he has created all those things for the people. And he is a,
more importantly, he is a schools and education.
Yeah, he's a friend. Yeah, he's a friend of mine. He's a very good friend of mine. We work very together. I invited Dr. Geeta Malhotra, the country director of Read India, but I think she's busy somewhere, so she could not do. I also invited my friend, you know, Bakshi Jai. Anyway, so it was, I must tell you, it was a wonderful presentation, documentation presentation. And we have a small curiosity from Dr. Anjani Kumar Jha. He's asking, Sundari, there is some tree called Sundari. What is the relationship between Sundari and Sundarban, if you have little knowledge about it? And Momita, there is like our student, says, Monica, thanks to Vaisakhi ma'am and Kailash Kumar Mishra. Thank you, Momita. We are really happy to see you here. Thank you. God bless you. Please talk about little bit about the Sundari tree and the Sundarban. Yes.
Thing is, there can be two meanings. Actually, some people say because it's a beautiful forest, and beautiful is Sundar in Bangla, and bone is forest, so Sundarban. But some other people say no, it's because of the Sundari tree, which is Heritage Fomes, which is the basic main tree in the Sundarban area, which has the steep roots and all. From that, the name came, that Sundarban. It has a Sundari tree or a beautiful forest. Either way, the name is Sundarban.
Anjani Jha, Dr. Anjani Jha also wants to know, he says that please tell something about the strength and weaknesses of the Sundari tree. But I will tell you the salient features he wanted to know. What are the salient features about the Sundari tree? Can you tell something?
Yes. They have these stilt roots which come up to the soil with the breathing path above. And the roots are like wires. I showed you some pictures of the roots and they hold the soil. You saw the soil of Sundarban is a very semi-solid kind of a thing. It's not a dry one and it gets wet twice every day. So what the roots do is that they hold on to the soil and they prevent it from getting eroded. So the more Sundari tree and the more mangrove forest we have in Sundarban, the more soil we preserve.
You know, you are talking about the, salt in the water. So, Haryana, we have alkaline, the soil is alkaline, so water is full of alkalinity. So that way, we have been facing this problem. Vinita Bhatia says, hope this concern is felt by policy makers. We have to save the Sundarban area. Agreed.
Thank you, Vinita. I hope so too. Yeah.
We are a small fish, but even though we will try to hammer, the mindset of the policy makers will reach to them.
Definitely.
I will reach to them as scholars, as activists, and will tell them, look, this is the situation. This is the ground zero situations, and they can take care. And I have worked in entire, bowl community and other community also. Are there any bowls? Because you have talked about Dutara. And so is there any bowl community living in the area or not?
Yes, there are bowl communities in that area. Also, the bowl is predominantly in the western part of West Bengal from that Birbhum area. So, but now bowl is found everywhere and they're also there in Sundarban. Dotara is a very simple instrument that can be used because as I told you, Bhatiali songs, they don't use a lot of music. So for them, just to keep the rhythm, a bit of dotara is enough.
I was working with a fisher folk community of Pondicherry, and there is a village. I'm just forgetting the name of the village. That village, it's a sea village. And the beauty of that village, that the fisher folk, by seeing the color of the sand of the sea, they understand that the storm with this much intensity would come in this in 2 hours, 3 hours, 4 hours. Accordingly, they take the decision. We say the indigenous calculation, indigenous science, indigenous mathematical, calculation they do, and that calculation is marvelous. So have you offered this kind of indigenous knowledge base with the people living in the Sundarban?
Yes, definitely, especially the fishermen who go out into the sea. By the look of the water, they can predict the weather. They have such rich treasury of indigenous knowledge. And if this ecosystem is destroyed, we lose that indigenous knowledge as well. They have the knowledge of
medicinal
plants.
Have you? I have a counter question. Have you recorded those indigenous knowledge systems systematically, the way they are existing with them?
There are a number of projects going on in Sundarban. Sundarban, thankfully, the NGOs have given a lot of attention to Sundarban, and there is a lot of work going on. In fact, INTAC has done some work. So there is enough documented evidence and documented research work. But what we do not want is that, it, for example, when I told you about the Bhatiali song, now the Bhatiali song is made naturally by the boatmen. But nowadays we have these motorized boats. So naturally the sound of the motor in the boat drowns the boatman's song. So how do you compromise? So that is a big issue. So the boatman can't sing because the motor, the sound of the motor is so huge.
I have one more thing to know from you, ma'am.
Yes.
You take my curiosity, but you put yourself in a position of a teacher and me as a student. You have talked about indentured tea labor, indentured labor who have gone from all the way from Chhatanagpur, now Jharkhand, where I was born and brought up, you know. And you have talked about Udao and all those communities. Now, what is the status of indentured labor who went, must be around 150 years, 130 years ago, roughly about 95 and 75 years ago, not more than that. What is the status of these people?
No, we don't have any indentured laborers as such in the world right now. Because as you know, the Sikkim government, when they were in power, they did this land distributions. So everybody has a little bit of land for themselves. So indentured labor, as in the sense that we know in the British period, that is no longer there. But maybe
indentured came in British period only.
Yes, yes. Maybe in the village area, some people, they may work, but not to my knowledge that much. Everybody has got a bit of their land.
So I think we don't have any more questions. We have so many suggestions, all good suggestion, better suggestion, and the best suggestion. And suggestion is to protect the bioculture diversity, intangible and tangible culture heritage of Sundarban, bioculture diversity of Sundarban, nature of Sundarban, beauty of Sundarban. Let us make efforts to see that the Sundarban remains Sundarban. So that the land beautiful should always be land beautiful.
Land beautiful,
like it is beautiful. Yeah, yeah. So thank you once again. Thank you so very much for coming to our the page, and we are enlightened, and we will keep on troubling you in future also, and maybe we will invite you to deliver again a talk on the interest of your choice, the subject in which you are doing your extensive research work. And we are trying to bring the scholarship to the common people. As the common people have, scholars should not be restricted to the academic room or seminar hall. You know, they should come to the public space. So these are the cyber public space where citizens and netizens have right to see in this. Thank you so very much again coming to our space. I think you must have enjoyed.
Thank you.
Namaskar.
Namaskar. Thank you. Bye.